是。
OK。
This pedal will be held in Chinese, and I would translate for myself. But we also have very our outstanding bachelor student and also the feminist panel directors, Mu Zhe and Zhuo Yu, to translate for the directors. So directors, please give our interpreter some time after maybe two sentences of free. 好的，那我们就开始吧。Let's start. Okay. 好，那。第一个问题呢，就是，可能这个问题可能也是大家常常会想问导演，就是导演是怎么样选择，电影这个艺术之路和这个媒介的呢？Are there any moments in life that make you feel very certain that film or documentary, in Mr. Huang's case, should be your type of art and your type of media? 那我们就请问麦克风还好吗？
没开。
哦，好。
喂喂，
哎，还来了，哦哦。
大家可以听到吗？是不可以的，请。
喂喂，嗨，
听得到吗？
没开。
听得到。
有开的。
哎，有了。
嗨。
有了。那我们就先从坐最近的黄导开始。Let's start with Mr. Huang。
你的问题是？
就是啊，请问您是怎么样走上就是电影或是纪录片这条道路的呢？
其实是一个蛮意外的过程，就是，在学生时代，就是因为参与社会运动，那参与社会运动的过程里面，曾经尝试过用照片跟文字的方式去报道。那在台湾的部分，因为社会运动开始跟政治结合，那我自己并不是很喜欢政治的整个运作方式，然后于是在思考说自己可以用什么样的方式继续参与社会运动。那除了参与社会运动的团体之外，有没有可能用个人的方式去参与？于是那时候 ，OK，Sorry。
Yeah, so it was a pretty surprising journey for me. So it all started when I started getting involved in my student life in some social movements. And I used to like the form of pictures, using pictures to transmit messages. And I didn't like the way politics worked back then. So I was thinking about how to get involved. So thought of pictures.
那后来我就找到了一个用纪录片的方式，自己带着摄影机拍摄关于家乡的环境议题，然后从此开始走入纪录片的拍摄。那 OK。
And then I realized that I could make documentaries and use documentary to enter the world of like political movements.、
那在纪录片拍摄大概18年后才拍了第一部剧情片。
Yeah, it was 18 years after I started filming documentaries that I started making a grant film.
那how about Mr. Wen? 那文导的电影之路是怎样的？
我就是从小到大学习特别差，特别差，对。所以我在这压力很大嘛，这都是学习特别好。我高考只打了290分吧，然后也是就是基本上到了没有学上的程度。但是小的时候有一个特点，就喜欢看电影，喜欢看漫画，然后我就选了一个当时我唯一一个能上得了的学校，就因为分太低了嘛，只有一个选择，还得是我爸找人上的的。对，那个学校新开设了两个专业，一个专业叫教育技术专业，一个专业叫广播电视编导。我因为我喜欢看电影，我觉得广播电视编导跟电影有点关系，我就报了这个。
Okay, so for me, and from Mr. Wen, he said he was a very bad student when he was young, and so he's under a lot of pressure today when he's exhausted with so many like good students, and he only got 290 for his Gaokao exam, and not many schools was able to take him, so he actually used his father's guanxi to get one of the schools. And they only had, at that time, there's only two major that he was really interested in. One of them is education technology, and the other is related to media and filmmaking. And from his personal interest, he chose to pursue a career in media and film.
然后这个专业其实就是我觉得跟电影有点关系嘛，我就上了这个专业。然后在大学一年级的时候，要拍个作业，我当时就为了拍这个作业，就自己学剪辑啊，学写剧本啊。然后，在学校放的时候，我第一次，因为从小坏学生嘛，老师从来不表扬，就是只有骂，没有夸。但是在那一次课上，老师第一次夸了我说：“你好像还挺有天赋的。”那个是一个坏学生第一次有一点尊严的感觉。对，然后就我觉得我想学这个专业，虽然学习很差，但是好像后来我的朋友跟我说学这个专业不需要学习很好。
OK. So his very first film project was actually a homework project when he was a junior in university, and he got a lot of praise for his work, and that's what got him started on filmmaking. And he was.At first, he was worried because he's not a good student. He might not be able to do well in this career path. But then his friends told him, "Oh, to be a film director, you don't have to be a good student." So that was really reassuring.
但是他其实是说了一半对的，因为我后来想要学这个专业，想要进到就是大陆电影的这个环境里面，必须要考到电影学院。所以为什么说一半对呢？是因为我考了三年，就是因为学习太差了，然后最后终于。三年考了三年的电影学院，我在北京拍广告和 MV 生存，然后最后差了过了一分吧，英语就是英语分数过了一分，进了电影学院，然后就开始真正进到这个电影的行业里面，就是这样。
But like he think it was half a sentence left unsaid because you do need to be a good student to pursue a career in film. He actually tried for three times to.Just get into one of the film schools and was able to pass the English exam by just one mark, and he was really fortunate. And in order to do the entrance exam, he has to take a lot of like extra job when he was in Beijing, and also took a lot of advertisements. Jeez. Yeah.
Then how about?Our Mr. Xing, the Xing 导。
文导说他成绩不好，但他最起码还上电影学院。那我电影学院都没考上，然后，所以可能我们就作为是按照学习成绩来排的。因为其实，我觉得可能我们这一代年轻电影人都是因为很小就喜欢电影，所以我那个愿望也特别的强大。然后在高中时候，我就决定我说我想找地方去学电影，然后不想再念文化课了。
So, Mr. Singer said, Mr. Mood said that it was a lot of effort for him to get into a film school, but at least he got into a film school. I didn't even get into a film school myself. And he thinks that the people his age, they usually started liking film since a very young age. And for him, it was since his high schools that he started getting into film.
然后就在外面反正各种地方去学，然后想要找机会进入到这个行业。然后我其实最早对于所有我不确定自己是不是要做导演，只是对电影很好奇，然后我差不多把跟电影有关的工作摄影剪辑编剧都做了一遍。然后大概可能快到30岁的时候，我觉得这样一直在这个行业的边缘晃悠好像也不是一个事儿，所以我想那要不给自己一次机会，就是你完全屏蔽掉所有的工作，然后踏踏实实去写一个剧本，然后把它实现拍出来，可能它能够决定你是不是有机会进入到这个行业，然后也看你是不是真的有这个能力。
So initially he wasn't sure whether he wanted to be a director, so he tried all different sorts of roles around filmmaking, and up until the age of 30 when he thought, I can't just like try different things and not settle for something. So I'm going to try and write an actual script for film, and that's how he started.
所以后来我大概花了2年时间，然后完成了我的第一部长篇新迷宫的剧本，然后在很艰难的环境下，最后把它实现出来。 然后可能用这一部电影就进入这个行业嘛，对。
It took him 2 years to write a complete script and also realize that make it into a complete film through despite the scarcity of resources, and that was the product that he used to enter the world of film.
那黄导，我刚刚没有问，就是您是怎么样从纪录片转型到拍剧情片的呢？How did you transform from a documentary film director to a film director?
我没有念过电影，然后我是后来有去念纪录片的研究，然后我在28岁的时候拍我第一部纪录片作品，然后43岁的时候拍第一部剧情短片，然后44岁吧拍我第一部剧情长片。那我第一次写剧本应该就是42岁写我的短片剧本，然后我的第一部剧情长片也是我的第一次写长片剧本。
So for me personally, I didn't go to film school either, but I did. So my transformation from documentary to film started pretty late. So the first documentary I made was at 28 years old, and my first ever short film was made when I was 43 years old. And then at 42 years, I made my first script, which was made into an actual film when I was 44.
那所以基本上我是一个不会写剧本的人。那我就是拍了很多年的纪录片，很想拍尝试不同类型的影片，不见得是剧情片。当时也想要拍广告、拍实验片，然后刚好有一个机会，想说那可以来拍剧情片试试看。
So I was not professionally trained as a filmmaker, but I tried many different genres of.Videos and screenplays such as documentary and advertisements, and when I was in my 40s, I got the opportunity to make an actual film, so I thought I might as well try.
所以大概我在41岁、42岁那时候开始想要有一个拍摄剧情短片的念头，于是找了一个学姐一起合作，那她会写剧本，然后我们投了一些投资计划，但都没有成功。
When I was 41, I got this opportunity to make a film with a senior, and we made lots of plans, but didn't get any investment actually.
然后隔年的时候，我又开始有一个想法，想要再拍剧情短片。然后因为前一年的投资计划都没成功，于是也不好意思再找学姐帮忙写。所以我就把剧本拿来，然后看想说，大概这样子写，于是我就。照着那个方式自己写了一个短片剧本。
So the next year, I still wanted to make this film, but because our first plan didn't work out, so I was a bit ashamed. I didn't, so I didn't ask my senior to work with me, and I just looked at the screenplay and said, "Oh, this seems to be the way it should be done," and created my first ever script.
然后到了长片剧本的时候，挑战更多。但是因为我遇到我的监制，在他的鼓励下，我比较多的自由空间，然后于是我就是跳脱以往台湾的剧本格式，写的比较像是一个故事、一个小说的概念。那我们就用这样的一个比较小说概念式的剧本来把它拍成长片。
I was really fortunate to be able to work with my producer who gave me lots of space to create my own thing. So my first screenplay used the concept of a novel in a screenplay because I wasn't able to do a professional screenplay, but it was a really creative approach.
所以简单来讲就是一个自己想做的短片做完之后被监制发掘，然后在他支持下才得以拍长片。
It was a really lucky moment for me because I made this short film that was based on a very creative, my very own concept, and was being discovered by my producer, who was able to make it into a long film.
Okay, 那这几个导演作品呢，都是通过讲述我们身边平凡人的百味人生来揭示比较深层的社会议题。然后，那么第二个问题就是，不知道是什么让导演就是有所触动去拍这种类型的电影。All the directors addresses structural social problems by telling very rich and complex stories of ordinary people. And we would like to know what leads the directors to shoot films as such. Maybe we can start with Mr. Wen. 哦，就是您是就是在选材上是为什么会选择就是通过讲述比较平凡人的人生来揭示比较深刻的社会议题？我是当时。
其实我这个题材上更感兴趣的是，因为它的起点是一个平凡的人，但是它最后的落点其实是一个不平凡的人。就其实它的张力来自于一个再平凡的，甚至阴沟里的人也有可能成为一个英雄。那这个故事是这么一个故事。我感兴趣是在这儿，然后再有就是因为这个题材涉及到生老病死里边的病和死，但是其实这个电影到最后传递出来的能量又是告诉我们怎么生，所以说白了就是生老病死里边至少有三个字头都占全了啊。然后这就是我对它感兴趣的很大的原因。然后再有就是这个题材我们国内可能没有过相对商业化的表达，商业化的表达有可能像这样的题材我们都会做成一个相对偏小众的艺术电影的一个范畴，所以我想尝试一下怎么能把它做到一个相对类型化的展现，所以这也是个人兴趣的一个原因。
So the reason I really like Dying to Survive is because how it starts with an ordinary individual, but then in the end, the individual turns out not to be so ordinary for what he has done. The topics in the film touches like involve like getting ill, so diseases, dying, and then it ends up with like this hope and life. So that is that touches on three essential topics that we have like in our lives, apart from the fourth of like just getting old. So that's it's significant for me, and also it's not a very popular style of film, so I wanted to try something new and then bring it into the popular like I, yeah.
我说完了。
好。另外就是我们论坛形式就是比较轻松，就是如果两位导演也想就是随时加入另一位导演的话题，请就是随时加入，然后我们就可以比较轻松的聊。OK, yeah, we can jump in anytime we like. 那新导是如何选择您的两部长片的？
我觉得这个问题好像在创作之初你不太会认为我要把摄影机对准所谓的平凡人，因为其实我们都是平凡大众，所以可能一开始去打动你的是一个故事，或许是打动，或许是某种触动，也可能是某种惊吓或者是好奇心，所以你就去挖掘他们背后的人物的动机或者人性的那种选择，然后你就把他们编织在一起，然后成为了一个电影的剧本，然后去呈现出来。当然可能后面很多看过电影的观众会觉得，哦，你看到了，因为可能我两部电影都讲到了中国的乡村，所以他们会觉得这可能不是我们日常生活中所关注的那个主流的群体，那可能通过一个电影他会觉得让我们看到了另外的一种真实的存在。那这些其实在一开始并不在我的创作的诉求里头，所以如果
So for me personally I wouldn't actually decide to useJust an ordinary person's perspective when I was first started writing. So I would focus on the things that interest me in life, such as use my personal curiosity and actually to discover what is interesting about this world. And when I find something interesting, I will think deeper about humanity and why people make their decisions and what are their motivations. So for both of my films, they were in a countryside setting, which is not a very popular setting, and also lots of people, the audience wouldn't be able to personally see the background of the story, but that wasn't my initial interest, and they might be a great focus on the setting of my film, but For me, I would say I rather choose my thing based on the motivation and choice decision of people.
生活周遭就是这些人，那对我来讲，我就是描述我所熟悉的人，然后我熟悉的环境，然后我也觉得这些人是绝大多数的人，只是在不管或文学或电影里面比较少以他们作为主角去描述他们的故事，那对我来讲，我就是想要讲一下他们的故事。
这个里面的他们是杜才还是 Kevin？
都是。
OK, cool. And then, OK.
So I usually start with people I'm familiar with. So people around me, the way people and environment that I am familiar with. I think that is the way most people are, but I don't think that's a common starting point for most films. And so I want to present what is like usually not being presented.
Then a few follow-up questions regarding each film. So first one is for director Xing, and also other directors, please feel free to jump in. So 我想问新导的问题就是说，就是其实可能也是因为我也是一个厨子，所以我就是对你的那个电影里面运用到的食物，我就觉得你的选的食物还蛮特别的。然后比如说你新迷宫里面，你就是让村长就是吐出了就是。他老婆刚刚烤好的烧肉，然后《爆裂无声》里面呢，你就是当然羊肉大家都能观察到，然后我也很想知道为什么当时会让昌万年去吃那个番茄，然后所以我想知道就是你创作的时候为什么会选就是这几种特别的食物作为这个就是里面你要运用的符号呢？So when I was watching the movie by director Xing, I was pretty much obsessed with the fact that he used food as the symbol. So for instance, in the film Deep in the Heart, he was using the barbecued meat, and then in Rust Silence, we have a very strong impression of the lamb as well as the tomato. And I would like to know, like, why did he pick specific food items in films?
我觉得因为首先可能在生活中我是一个还蛮喜欢做饭的人，所以平时对于食物的接触然后观察，而且我觉得其实在这个信仰缺失的当下，可能做饭是一种修行吧，所以经常可能做着做着就会觉得我是否可以在电影里面能够怎么去运用食物的那种魅力或食物的某种象征意义。因为在《爆裂无声》里面，其实所有的食物是精心安排的，因为它不太像以往的那样的叙事电影，它有某种预言的这样的一个载体在，所以我会希望可能每一样道具、每一样镜头里看到的东西，都有它的自己的意义。那可能在番茄的处理上，开篇那场戏，其实如果观众能够完整的把那场戏的调度还有人物的状态吃透的话，其实在第一场戏就告诉你这个人物他做了什么，然后他之后整部戏其实做的事情都跟他第一场戏做的事情是一样的。那我觉得这也是可能电影语言的魅力所在，就你可能不完全通过故事或者通过对白和一个动作去了解人物，而可以通过他周遭的所有的东西去了解这个人物的塑造。那包括可能羊肉，它也符合在西北的那样的环境里面出现的这样一种很常用的食材。那张宝民家又在放羊，然后所以可能他完成了某种食物链的一种隐喻吧。所以我觉得可能这样的人物本身，你在拍摄这样的人物的时候，你也需要给他安排到很多生活的细节，那免不了就是衣食住行。所以我觉得如果很好的又在另外一个层面补到了电影没有办法去直抒胸臆的那种东西，可以隐隐的带给观众一些别的含义，那我觉得可以这么做。
So very first reason is I love cooking, and the second reason I have because I think in today's China and world, people lack faith in a lot of things, and food acts as a reassurance to a lot of things in life. So especially in my films, I wanted to make use of every opportunity to convey the meaning and I want to convey, and film is special in the way that it doesn't only need to be dialogues or acting. I can actually make use of everything in the frame to convey the things I want to say, and food, especially in the northwestern China countryside setting, I think it's really convenient to use lamb in my film as a metaphor to lots of motivation behind the character's behavior and use these details to make it a multi-layered communication.
文导吃橘子吗？
你知道，那电影里边吃橘子的人都死了。不是，听着对，对对对，就别乱。是，这还是跟食物有关是吗
？Yeah。
啊。
其实为什么当时就是你要让兽医吃橘子？
啊不，他其实是这样，他这个其实我没想那个意义上的事情，就是因为这是。我在跟王传君就是演吕受益那个演员讨论这个角色的时候，他说他去白血病的那个病房里面去体验生活的时候，那儿天天有一个老大爷，就每天定点就要吃橙子，因为补充维生素。他觉得他说这个挺有意思的。我说那橙子就我就拍的时候你扒起来太费劲吧，你不能就掏出来拿把刀再切呗，你知道吧？那个就是你就会很。我说我没有那个时间给你这么长的镜头，他说那咱们吃橘子好，所以这个橘子其实是这么构成的，然后就把它变成一个故事里面相对一个线索，它是一个情感寄托，包括彭浩去在那个吕受益死的时候坐在那儿吃橘子，这个他就连上了。但是其实有的时候，我说老实话是没有意义在，我没有想意义，我只是说这个的现实的意味。它有一定的会让人解读的空间，但是我并没有想它有什么可能解读出来的东西。它首先得符合现实，对，它其实是给演员一个支点，说白了。
So I just raised a question like, do you want orange? Because this is a line like in Dying to Survive. So.
Yeah, so I usually don't think of the symbol behind the food I use. So the usage of Mandarin actually started because I was visiting patients who suffered from leukemia in hospital, and I saw that they eat oranges a lot. And so we thought, oh, that's something real, and we want to translate that to our film. But it's not very easy to like eat an orange because you have to cut it, you have to peel it. So I was like, I don't have that much time for this specific scene. So what can we do? Let's just replace it with mandarins instead, so because they're easier to peel and to film. But in general, I don't think of what exactly each food means when I make the film. I do leave some room for interpretations for the public, but I don't think of a specific meaning that I want to convey with the food.
那黄导的鸡腿杜菜四千只鸡腿，你要告诉我们的？
其实。台湾在执行死刑的前一餐，通常都会有鸡腿。
鸡腿也不标示更加。
所以那时候在安排杜才吃他人生的最后一道菜的时候，那时候刻意加了鸡腿这样一个隐喻。那其实是有其实知道的人并不多。但对我来讲，知道的就会知道，那不知道的，我们就是把它当成是一个增加菜色的概念。
So, I actually use drumstick chicken in my film as a symbol because in Taiwan, when the criminals with death penalty are sent to their death, and the last dinner they will actually have a drumstick in their dinner, and not. Everyone knows it, but for those who know, it will be kind of an Easter egg in my film that's convey another layer of meaning.
There's another symbol that two of the directors here actually use in your movies, which is wick. 还有另外一个符号，我也觉得挺妙的，就是在场的黄导和新导都有在你们电影中运用，就是假发。而且在你们电影之中，都是一个上层社会的男士在做非常暴力的事情的时候，突然之间假发掉了。但是这个时候做完了暴力的事情之后，马上把假发带回来。而且这个镜头就蛮让人记得的。So, could you please explain why do you think wig is so important for like high social class elite men when they're executing something that is extremely violent?
假发的概念其实就 我先从我们很喜欢自拍开始讲起，就是我们常常会自拍，然后透过修图的 APP， 然后修完之后传给朋友，朋友还会问你说这是谁。
So to start to talk about Wix, I'll actually start with another thing that we usually do, which is to take selfies. So we normally take selfies and then we edit the pictures, we Photoshop them and then send it to friends, and then our friends ask, oh, who is this?
然后其实片子里面戴假发这个人其实代表的就是这个社会很多人的伪善。那他的伪善有的时候你会认不起自己，会不知道到底哪一个才是自己。那他可能就是一面做着善事，一面做着坏事，可是他会觉得他其实是在做好事的人。
And this is like a simile for how some people or the characters in the films, when they act in a way, so like they're actually doing certain evil things, but then they think that they take themselves to be doing some very good things, and it's actually they're not really being like a good person. So it's this contrast between like they do things which are evil, but also like some good things, but then they consider themselves to be very a really good person.
简单讲就是说，我们可能会对外营造自己一个形象，那这个形象其实不见得是自己内心真正的样子，可是你最后会说服自己，其实你就是那个外在的样子，那这就是那顶假发的意义。
And how we as people, we also tend to form and create this impression or like outer look that people see of us, the way people get to know us, so this impression that we want to create and give to the rest of the world, but whereas actually inside we are not exactly at the way we present ourselves, and this is, but in the end, because we keep pretending that we are the person we want to be, like, or want to be seen as to the rest of the world, we end up becoming this sort of person. We end up believing that we are this sort of person rather than the person we really are inside.
所以那我的电影里面的那个角色他就有讲说，这顶假发其实他戴久了都会觉得那是他的真头发。那就像是我们不管是在 Facebook 或者其他的交友软件，你会觉得Facebook 上面那个才是真正的，而不是现在真实的。
So the wig also represents, the wig and the character who wears it. We see how, because of wearing the wig for so long, they actually end up thinking, believing that the wig is their true hair. So, it's this habit, and it's the same as like how we end up believing that our Facebook profiles, what our Facebook profiles present the rest of the world, is the sort of person we really are.
行到了，好吧，我们执行。
可能在剧作的时候，我觉得可能那个想法和用意跟黄导的感觉是差不多的。但是我一开始其实只是在他的生活环境，在他的那个装束上做了一些这样的设计，但头发其实还没有想到，直到姜武老师来试镜，然后到现场我们做那个造型的时候，发现他头发其实有点稀，而且也很短，所以这个我说那能有问造型师能有什么样的处理，他说那你要不就抹油然后梳开，那我觉得也不好看。后来姜武老师自己提到说，那你能不能给我戴假发，我觉得我说这个不太像我一开始对这个人物的那种要求，但是他说其实可以，要不把假发就当成片子里面的一个道具，因为他后面还有很多动作戏，我在想如果是假发的话，动作戏可能会穿帮。
So for me, at first, I didn't think of using wig as a symbol in my film, but until my actor, Mr. Zhang, when he came, I realized his wig looks a bit new. And so we tried to change that, but eventually decided maybe we can use that as a prop in the film to convey a certain meaning.
所以后来我觉得呢，如果我们定义上就他给他自己加的一些发片，然后在最终可能在我们对这个人物有越来越深的了解之后，他突然把头发摘掉了，那 因为我们就在一个这样一个犯罪悬疑的一个类型里面，那可能观众会突然发现这个人物他背后还隐藏了多么大的一种邪恶，所以我觉得突然可能对这个人物有特别好的一个塑造，于是就这么用了。
So in the film, we actually added more fake hair, more wigs, to the actor's head. And in the process of the film, the characters was able to take off those fake hair and a bit by bit. And we were able to go deeper and deeper into who this character really is. And I think it acts really nicely to tell the story to the audience.
那就是想问文导的问题，就是文导除了我不笑成这个电影之前也有拍一些短片嘛，比如说 Battle， 再比如说安魂曲，然后这些短片其实我不知道，有一些短片是可以在现实生活中找到一些原型啊，包括新闻啊等等等等，所以我们就想知道就是导演是怎么样处理这些现实事件和作为一个电影或者是短片的再创作，文艺再创作之间的关系。 How do you deal with the social reality and the social issues thatinspire your work and the representation that you use in your film as your art?
这对我来说现实事件就是只是种子，就是它萌生你对于这个故事或者这个人的兴趣，然后后面基本上发展的所有的东西都跟这个种子只有就是说因果的关系，后面不会被它限制，就是取材于它，但是要突破它，这是我对于这类的新闻的改编的一个经验嘛。
So for me, reality just make up the seeds for the film. So the seeds are where the interest for the story both will emerge from, and everything that happens later on in the film will be linked to the seed by cause and effect. But that then has nothing to do with reality anymore. It's more just the reality is just the starting point of my film rather than the whole of it.
我觉得这个问题其实跟黄导也有一些关系吧，因为其实纪录片这个东西，我们说现实故事，然后再说电影再创作，有的时候现实和电影再创作，再包括纪录片接下来的是您再创作吗？还是它就是更真实的？或者是纪录片和在电影的这个门类里，你觉得他们处理就是现实生活中的真真假假，就是有什么不一样呢？
纪录片其实。纪录片的类型非常非常多，我觉得有很多纪录片是虚构的。那我觉得如果要在这边讨论纪录片的类型或者界定纪录片这件事情，我觉得其实是有点困难的，因为到现在其实最早我们会去谈纪录片，其实最早溯源就会讨论到英国，那到目前大家还是没有办法去界定纪录片的定义到底是什么。我觉得创作就是这样，不需要去界定这么多。那故事片当然就是这样，我讲就是你用十个真实的故事把它合在一起，其实它就是一个虚构的故事。
So documentary actually have lots of different types, and it was first started in the UK, but for me personally, I wouldn't try to draw a line between fiction and documentary. I think they actually lie in a spectrum, and when you put 10 true stories together, it's actually a fictionary film. So even though all the content is real, and I would still not call it a documentary anymore.
所以有的时候我会觉得以剧情片来讲，它会比真实的生活里面更真实。例如说我们常常会去讨论到某个人的故事，发生的故事，说你发生的个故事很像电影，那其实就是说其实人生本来就是充满了故事性。
So sometimes even though the stories and films are made up, they are actually truer or more real than the stories we tell in actual life. And I think life is made up of stories, and I think it's an intertwined relationship between true life stories and the stories in the film.
有回答你的问题。
有。好，谢谢。Okay. So before opening to the floor, I just have one last question that the audiences might want to ask too, which is, could you please give us some spoilers of the films that you are shooting now or the plots that you are working at the moment? 不知道就是导演可不可以给我们剧透一下现在您在准备的新的片子或者是写剧本是什么类型的呢？ Maybe we can start with 新的。
我要想想该怎么讲。对，其实一开始是在暴裂无声做后期的过程中，然后开始因为你忙了一段时间的拍摄之后，突然有时间开始看很多的书，然后发现一个话题很有意思，就是关于科技的发展，然后对人的影响，以及你可以在不久的将来去预感到某种爆发。对，所以我很想在这样的一个议题上去做一些研究。然后但是后来发现，其实你一旦撕开了这个话题，真的是无限无限的内容，而且会发现很多可能这种感觉是什么样，就像比如说可能几千万年以前我们在非洲大草原上，大家都是动物，然后在一个水塘里面喝水，然后突然听说好像隔壁不远的树林里面有一些猩猩可以直立行走了，然后我们说完之后还继续喝水，但可能再过了几千万年之后就是这样了。所以我觉得好像当下我们的确需要关注到一些科技领域的事情，因为我有时候跟别人讲，可能我会更直观说我在写个科幻，但其实当下我们对科幻的理解我觉得也是不一样的。对，可能我们今天跟非洲的一些部落，可能跟硅谷之间就存在着某种对于科技的一些误差吧，你觉得？所以可能这是一个蛮大的话题，但是在不断的这种筛选以及更新的过程中，会找到一些可能放到一个故事的落点里面可以去讲的事情。
So everything actually starts in the later stages of the filming of Wrath of Silence, because I got a bit more of time and started to read more and more books. And then I just realized how the evolution of technology and its effects on humanity, as well as how like ultimately it's, we envision it to like explode at some point. All of this has a lot of influence in nowadays thinking, and I think it's a very interesting topic because, to tell a story, if you imagine like animals drinking water in Africa, like drinking water from a lake, and then you have like some huge animals like walking past in the forest on the side, you probably ignore them at the start and like keep drinking water, but then at some point they're going to affect your life. So this is the way I see technology, and it's like evolution right now. So if I answer your question, I will say that I'm writing science fiction, but it's all about iterating until I find a right story that like emerges from it.
就是可能科技的发展会打破原有的一些所谓的阶层的壁垒，但也有可能会树立更高或者更坚固的壁垒。那我觉得这个的确可能不在我们每一个人的一个意识和关注过的这种，对，不在你的注意力里面。但有天它真的形成的时候，你会发现你再也没有机会去推翻它。
So I think technology, with the evolution of technology, it will end up breaking certain like social class or social like kind of walls that we have already formed. However, it will probably also build more of those walls or even harder ones. But it is in the process. It's this process that's very interesting and we want to explore.
So how about 黄导呢？
其实我就是一样在拍纪录片，然后也准备下一个剧情片。那剧情片的部分，其实我就是现在是会把它分成两个部分嘛。纪录片其实是比较自己内心的，那故事片是一个自己比较对外在世界的对话。那故事的内容大概就是我这个年纪吧，40几岁。40几岁，就是40几到50几，然后是这次的焦点是在上班族。然后我们都知道，例如说读大学也是可以到牛津跟剑桥，其实是少数的。在上班的时候，你可以升为主管也是少数的。那 到了四五十岁你还是一个一般职员的话会是什么样的状况。我想谈的是一个生命在不上不下，可是你又得面对你的生活跟家庭，那你一个就是一群中年男子的故事。
So I'm also filming documentaries, but I am also at the same time interested in drama films, and it's like two parts of me. So the documentary is like the inner part of me, whereas the drama films are like the outward part that I am showing to the world. And I think it's when you consider the like the world and you see people who get into Oxford and Cambridge, people who get promotions in job, people who like have very good things happen in life, it's actually, it doesn't happen to everyone, and it's actually a few people who get to these high places. So I want to just look at the story of like an ordinary man in the middle age, so when you don't have a lot of surprises in life and like not very great promotions or anything, it's and in, you're just in the middle, and what is going to happen then?
像我觉得我是比较幸运，例如说有机会被邀请到这里来跟大家见面。但我很多朋友其实就是一个，生活没有出口的人，可是又面对工作，你又不能换工作，因为你要转职是相当困难。然后回家又受不到家庭的肯定，公司又没有上司的支持，那在这个年纪的男子其实是很无助的。
So for me personally, it's very lucky that I get to be here today. But I know many people and even like friends of me, they don't have the same chance. They're not equally lucky, and for them.Their life, it's actually in a very difficult position right now. They don't really have a way out because they're experiencing difficulties at the job, but they can't change jobs that easily. It's middle age. Also, they might also have problems in life, family issues, and there are lots of difficulties coming from everywhere, and they don't have an easy escape. So it's actually a very hopeless feeling for them.
So, well, I know very well myself that as the director of this very popular panel, I would be very selfish if I keep asking questions. So I've left the audience around 15 minutes to ask questions. And then, okay, now we have many hands rising. We will start from the back. Is that fine? Do we have people passing the mic? Or I can just run.Could you ask your questions in both Chinese and English, please? Thanks.
就是我们可以看到，在韩国或者一些其他国家，有一些非常，就是挺现实性题材的，电影去反映某一种，社会问题。比如说韩国就有类似于，熔炉或者素媛，这样的电影。但是在中国的电影市场内，我们可以看到，其实这样的这样一种题材的电影还是挺小众的。我想问一下三位导演，你觉得在中国这样一个环境下，有没有什么就是可以怎样将这样一些很社会性的电影去放到一个更大众化的就是平台上，让更多人去看到、去了解这样的一些比较贴近我们的社会性议题。So we can see that in Korea and some other countries, there's some reality films which reflect some social issues. But in China, these kind of films are still like viewed by the minority of the society. So is there any ways that we can bring them to a higher level with more people watching this kind of films and reflecting certain social issues and also trigger discussion to let more people know this kind of problem. Thank you.
就是我大概只能讲台湾的部分，就是社会议题的电影，我觉得其实电影很重要一点，它就是一个资本集中的工业，那电影其实是一件商品，它是要卖的，那如果这件商品不好卖，其实就不会有人投资，那我觉得故事就是非常重要的。
So for me, my experience will be in Taiwan, and I want to highlight the fact that film is not just an art piece, it's actually a merchandise, a product that people want to sell. And the film industry is a very capital intensive industry, so that a good story telling must be supported by capital and by investment. And this is the reality of filmmaking that's true everywhere in the world.
台湾是一个电影市场非常小的地方，然后基本上大部分，大概我觉得大部分的电影都赔钱了，但是大家还是很有勇气继续拍。然后像我的电影是比较幸运，遇到一个监制愿意支持，否则我觉得关于社会议题的电影其实是投资者会比较少，本身会比较难做。那还有另外一个重点，就是观众愿意不愿意去观看。那我觉得韩国它有一个自己国家的民主性存在，那我觉得这是必须要去考量观众的这一块。
So, I also consider two perspectives. And firstly, from the investor perspective, Taiwan actually has a really small film market, and most of the films are losing money. So for me personally, I'm very lucky to have producers who actually like my story and want to work with me. But lots of other directors are not as lucky. And also from an audience perspective, and there's also different interests involved. So for Korea, they have a population that's really interested in national issues, and I think that also provides a breeding opportunity for films that reflect social issues to be able to be produced, but it might not be the case in other places of the world.
对，我觉得其实这个话题，我觉得文导会更有发言权，所以我让他压轴来讲。因为在国内，如果你做电影的话，你会发现像你讲的这种关于社会话题或者是现实描写的电影其实并不少，但它的确是小众，而且可能之前几年也有一些，比如说一些很好的导演或者一些我们讲可能是明星，他们也愿意希望去尝试这样的一种创作，但是你会发现他到了院线，到了影院经理那里来讲，他仍然认为这是很小众的电影，所以他还是不愿意给你拍片，然后最终这样的电影还是没有被很多人看到，所以可能我觉得这是一个在前进中的问题，就是在当下的确有很多普通观众也有这样一种诉求，他们希望在电影院里面看到他们的真实生活，不管就是某种呼声或者某种我觉得是一种共鸣还是怎么讲，就他会希望体会到那种我也可以体会到的痛或者某种不满，那可能最终最核心的是你要用一个什么样的方式去讲述这样的故事，所以的确你像在韩国你讲的那些电影，它在故事上也是要做一点点的，我觉得是做一点点打磨的，它不可能完全把那种真实的那种很尖锐的东西抛出来，那个我觉得可能一般的普通大众他也会接受不了，所以可能我觉得那在去年最典型的就是《药神》，因为最终还是这个故事然后打动了所有的观众，所以这个可能是会影响到后来几年很多华语电影想要去做这样尝试做这样的创作的过程中的一个可以去参考的案例吧。
So actually the films that describe reality issues and say documentaries, but those kinds of films are actually still the minority. Because there isn't, so first of all, as we have previously mentioned, you need capital. So, but even when you have made the film and you manage to make such a relatively minority kind of film, you still have difficulties when it comes to negotiating with cinemas and wanting them to offer you spaces for showing your films. And I think this in the end comes down to the public's needs, that the public still doesn't have as strong a need for this kinds of films. So I think it's very important then for when making those films to capture the base it on a very good story, and that is able to make the public resonate with the story being told. So I think this is it's also very difficult if say like the Korean films, when you want to when it shows a very strong, very sharp kind of feeling, if it's very difficult for the audience to resonate with, yet it might not be the good occasion just yet. And I think last year, very good example was Dying to Survive in China, how that really was a very successful film. So I think that's a very good example to follow first.
As the director of Dying to Survive, please share your
opinion. 我个人有一个把电影分层的一个方法。电影里边我自己觉得有三个东西，叫灵魂性、社会性和娱乐性。就任何一个电影基本上是用这三性去界定会比较容易一些。一般情况下我们看到社会议题的电影呢，它的社会性如果我们用五星来想的话，它可能是五星满星。灵魂性如果我们的故事讲得好的话，有可能三到五星。但一般这样的电影有一个此起彼伏的有一个这个就是有一个相对的好玩的地方，就是它的娱乐性一般我们都会降得很低。这个娱乐性决定了观众是不是能从电影的开头一直跟着你走到尾的一个根本性的东西。所以说实际上我想的就是，我拿到这个题材我要做的时候就是非常简单，我首先要保证娱乐性。这个娱乐性就是讲故事的方式，其实就是相对类型化的讲这个故事。我们话说回来，就是我们中国的电影可能把娱乐性和社会性这两层面分得过分的开。比如说我们有些导演拍的是纯粹的娱乐性电影，那现在中国开始进入一个这三性融合的一个阶段，就是娱乐性很多的这样的导演，或者说娱乐属性很高的这样的电影开始向社会性和灵魂性下降落。然后我们做社会性和灵魂性相对饱满的电影的时候，我们要想的是怎么样把它的娱乐性提起来，这个是根源的东西。因为我刚才说的这三性，就是娱乐性决定观众从头到尾是不是能跟得住这部电影，社会性决定观众看完电影之后出来是不是愿意讨论你的电影，灵魂性决定观众讨论这个电影的时间。所以说这个啊 sorry
so when I was making I see films as to have three different values. The first one is it's so the theme it has, I will tell it's the soul value, and the second one is its social value and how much it actually reflects the social reality. And the third level, the third value is this entertainment value. So in China, we will see a very predominant trend coming from the third value, that's entertainment value. And the entertainment value of the film determines the lens the public is able to pay attention and discuss the film. Well, actually, the depth of the discussion lies more with the first two values, which is the theme of the story and also its social value. So lots of directors in China are trying to make this effort from the entertainment oriented focus to a more deeper focus, a better focus on the theme of the story and also its social values. But still, when we are focusing on the first two values, we need to consider the entertainment value of the film as well, because that determines the size of the audience in the film and also how much impact you can have by telling the story.
刚才说到哪儿了？对，那个我知道。说到这个，我们刚才说灵魂性是观众看完电影之后的这个去思考它的时间，其实这样就会形成一个三角形，你的电影就会在这个三角形的矩阵里面来回的弹射。所以说一般说到了市场之后，如果我们去衡量一部电影这三性都是比较好的呈现的话，那么它的票房是不会差的。美国电影一直都是这个样子的。所以我想说的就是，实际并不是中国这个或者说我们国家这个电影环境不能产生社会议题的电影，产生社会议题的市场面的电影，只是可能是我们的电影创作者还没有找到用如何相对好的方式去呈现的。 其实我觉得有非常多很好的方式可以呈现我们国家的这个题材，慢慢的会有很多涌现出来，就是要尽量找到娱乐性、社会性和灵魂性的平衡。
So I would see these three values, the entertainment value, the social value, and the theme, the story as a triangle. And lots of the American blockbusters have a really good balance of all three values. And it is not that China don't have the societal environment for good films to be made, but that our creators and directors have not found the right way to balance all these three values. And it is also something that I personally would want to achieve.
Okay. I would actually want to know whether the audiences on the second floor would like to yell your question out, because I understand the pain of standing and everything. If no, we can come to this side. Maybe. Could you kindly wait for my microphone? And could you also ask if you can kindly wait for my microphone? Okay.
三位导演都是我近两年最喜欢的中国导演，然后我想问一下，就是三位导演就是在手头资源有限的时候怎么能表达自我又能顾及观众呢？然后When we have limited material in our world, how do you express yourself while addressing the audience?
这个观众应该是学电影专业的吧？
哦，我是学艺术专业的。
那为什么问一个关于创作的问题？因为其实这个，我觉得在你设定的这个情境里面，其实这不是一个大家惯常去考虑的问题。因为一上来肯定会先想到如何去实现，或者找一个什么样的话题去成为一个剧本的原型，然后去慢慢呈现它。在这过程里面，你说这两点可能都不是当下最主要去考虑的，而可能你面对的实际的包括制作或者是更核心的自己掌控的那个压力来讲的话，可能那个是你最先要考虑的。但是可能再到比如说之后你已经确定你 OK 可以拥有这样的一个制作能力之后，那我觉得很多观众会很多导演会在这个层面上会做一种取舍，也有可能会像文导所讲的，就你会找到一种折中的方式来让二者兼顾吧。
我觉得前提是对不起。
So actually the two points you mentioned, they're not probably the usual perspective from which we think about a film to start with, because as a director, the most eminent pressures that we have are for filmmaking itself and also other duties as a director. So we only come to think about those two points in the later stages, and each director will decide their own way of dealing with those. Maybe, for example, as director Wen Wuye just mentioned before, the balance between those three points and so on, as an example.
我觉得就刚才你说的问题，就是总结起来就是共性和个性之间的取舍，对吧？共性和个性之间取舍。首先是这样，首先你要知道，做一件事情是使你表达的共性更多会让你快乐，还是个性更多会让你自己快乐，这是根源的东西。然后你确定了这件事情之后，你还要确定一件事情，就是他们不可兼得，就是它永远都是此消彼长的关系，永远都是此消彼长的关系。就是你更加的面对观众，你的议题的深入程度就会更浅。它其实就跟针一样，越细的针它越容易扎得更深，但是它接触到的面就会越小，然后越大的面就会其实扎不进去的，它就会像一个钝器一样打在上面。所以比如说我做药神的时候就很清楚，我做的是一个锤子，它不是刀，它是钝器，所以我需要的是击打的面积而不是深度。你确定这个之后，你要做的就是保持你的面积的同时尽量的深一点。其实这个就是这个是方法论的事了，但是前提就是你自己喜欢那种，这是根源的东西。
So in filmmaking, there's this always this intricate balance between audience interest and my own interest. And I would see this as together with the metaphor of the needle. So the sharper the needle is, the deeper it is able to delve into, but a smaller pressure point is able to deal with. And when I was making the film Dying to Survive, I see my film as a hammer because it have a really large impact area, whereas I'm not trying to discuss too depth into those issues. So raising public interest in the topic is my main focus. So I think in the making of film and film scripts, there's always this balance between the depth of the topic and the impact, the size of the impact, and it is something more with the technique of script writing, and you will always need to consider.
我觉得如果是以艺术作品、以创作作品来讲的话，我觉得每个作品它的属性会不一样。那以电影来讲，它基本上是一个所谓的大众流行的文化艺术，然后再加上它本身的资本集中的特性，所以有的时候身为一个导演，你能够保持多少自我，其实是很难很难很难被具体描述到你能够坚持多少。
So when it comes to thinking about an artistic product, they have different essences. And as a film director, you have to take into account not only your own interest or your own character, but also the popular interest. So it's a difficult question how much of yourself, your own essence, you're able to keep in the end.
那你如果选希望你的作品能够跟最大多数的观众能够有所沟通，你就必须选择以白话文的方式。那如果你坚持自己要用文言文的方式创作你的作品，你就只能选择让少数懂得文言文的观众了解你的作品，这就是作者自己的选择。
谢谢。
If you choose to communicate with choose to want to reach a wider audience and communicate with more people, then it is like communicating in plain Chinese, so language that everyone will understand. Whereas if you choose to keep more of yourself and communicate to a more niche audience, then it's like communicating in traditional Chinese, but only a small portion of people will be able to understand you.
但是电影这件事情，当它具有商业机制底下的时候，其实会复杂很多，不是非黑即白，而是即使我们三个人是不同的类型故事，那我们下一个故事可能又是不同的投资者，我们又会产生不一样的东西，所以我觉得那是作为电影导演每次必须要面对的问题。
And especially when the commercial aspect of the films come into play, it becomes very complicated. Especially, so if you see the three of us, the three directors here, we all have different inner stories. So with our next film, there will also be different investors because of our different stories.
我很想借这个话题可能讲一下我的一个感受，因为可能我觉得在座也会有比如说学相关专业的同学，因为他讲到的那个环境是有可能你在拍摄你的前一两部作品，我觉得这可能存在一个问题，就是如果是针对你的早期的作品，我觉得作为你学电影的一个学生来讲，可能最核心的不是这两者，而是完成度。因为我觉得不管是自我的表达或者是讲好一个故事，其实完成度是你要在前面的作品里面尽可能去实现的，因为那过程里面你有一种对自我的记忆的一种认可和认知吧。因为我一直觉得电影其实像一种语言，就像可能你在学英文的过程中，你会从单词、从句，然后从语法。那可能我们在想，我今天要写一首诗或者要讲一个故事，前提是如果用英文的话，前提是你还是要把这些语法、句型都掌握清楚。所以尤其在前几部，可能那个完成度是最核心的。
And I will also have a few words with maybe some of the future aspiring directors who's still in school and might be making one or two of the first films in your career. I think for your first few films, the completion level of the film is more important than conveying a too deep a meaning, because it's like learning a language. So when you're first starting to learn, for example, English, the grammar of the sentence structure is more important than the content you want to convey, because it's only after you've mastered the grammar of English you're able to convey deeper meanings and have good stories. And so I want you to focus on the completion level of your film rather than those other things which you should consider only later on in your career.
我想问一个问题，是关于演员，就是我想问您，在您表达您的故事的时候，怎么去找到好的演员？然后，就是这个好的演员对您表达您的这个故事是不是很重要？然后最后是这些演员是不是都很贵？So I want to ask about actors and actresses in your film. Is it easy to find them, the good ones, and are they very important for you to express your message?And finally, are they very expensive in your cost?
Okay. 关于我的演员，就是我的长片是从短片发展过来的，所以我短片的两位主角也是我长片的两位主角。
So.
对。
So that my actors and actresses actually, because my long films came into what they are from the short films. So I also continued the trend, and the protagonist of my short film are the protagonists of my long film.
然后我在拍短片的时候，算是我第一部的剧情短片。然后以前拍纪录片，所以我没有认识任何演员。那其中有一位主角是我以前一起上班的同事。那他是我台湾唯一认识的一位演员，然后他的样子又很适合剧中的角色。那另外男主角是跟我一样是拍纪录片的导演，那他的样子更适合里面的角色。然后他们两个，一个是纪录片导演，然后一个是从剧场出身，然后原本是幕后的工作人员。然后他们对于我所描绘的人物，其实他们都很熟悉，所以他们很能够理解这些人的生活样貌跟讲话的样子。所以我当时会选择他们两位是这些原因综合起来。
So, it was my first drama short film, and one of the protagonists, we actually went to school together, and so I knew him from there, and I felt that his physical aspect, the way he looked, suits the character very well. And the other one we met just filming documentaries as well. And I felt like his physical aspect also, like, say, would be very suitable for the character. So I felt they, especially the very important thing is both of them were very familiar with the type of character I was trying to portray with my story. So it became a natural decision.
那因为那时候我在长片的时候，我跟监制我们都觉得我们不是一个能够卖得很好的电影，所以我们也没有太多票房的考虑，所以我们还是沿用两位短片的主角。那短片的时候，他们有一位没有收我钱，然后一位收我车马费，哦，因为那时候我们都没有钱。那到长片的时候，他们继续帮助我们，所以他们只很领很微薄的薪水。那因为他们当时也没有知名度，不过这部电影让他们现在有一些演出，当然他们的收入会不一样。
So when we were filming the long film, my producer and myself, we didn't think that would be a huge commercial success, so we didn't have a lot of pressure from that side. So the two actors that I had, one of them didn't get any monetary reward from me, and the other one only received some like small reimbursements for like logistic purposes. So, but then nowadays they are also like having their own commitments and commercial impact. So, yeah. So therefore, they also are gaining some salaries from that side.
我觉得电影来讲的话，最重要的头两名应该是剧本和演员。 剧本和表演，这是最为重要的。尤其在如果我们在刻意的分成，就是商业电影和文艺电影的话，那我觉得商业电影可能更需要好的故事和好的演员去呈现。那《药神》这个电影的剧组是很非常非常正规的一个就商业片的一个构成，就是我确定剧本，然后我去每个演员我去找。 大概这里边的演员可能有一半是我自己去找朋友联系，我确实也不认识什么演员，我的第一部电影处女作，但是我就得托关系去认识他们，然后缠着他们，然后把这个剧本讲给他们听，他们感兴趣就会谈成，还有一半呢就是正规的演员建组，就我们剧组建立起来之后，把这个组训发出去，就有一些演员会过来，比如说这里面。 演这个吕受益的王传君，就是看到组训之后过来面试的，还有谭卓也是看到组训之后自己过来的。我们会有大概会有很多备选，然后去选定一个，是这样进行的。像张宇这个演员，就是因为是最难的，就是黄毛那个彭浩的那个演员，是最难的，我找了很多都不太合适。然后有一天是宁浩导演推荐这个，说你可以看看他，然后我看到他的时候。 我就确定是他了，然后我甚至当时第一句话跟他说的就是，我说我很幸运能够碰到你这个演员，是因为这个角色太难了，他需要那个需要非常的厚，就这个人的感觉非常的厚实，那同时要特别的透，就是又厚又透是很难做到的，你可能找到那种年轻的演员很，对不起。Okay.
So I think the most important component of a film is script and actor. And for a commercial film, more than independent films, you need good script and good actors. And so for my last film, Dying to Survive, and I was really clear that I wanted to be a commercial film. So I had to pull a lot of strings to get to know those famous actors I didn't. And wasn't able to approach before. And we also made some selections from the public pool when we send out our, okay, so, and also, especially for my character Zhang Yuan, and it's a really interesting character that was difficult to choose an actor for this role. And I actually was able to get in touch with the actor through recommendation from a fellow director.
我是觉得，就是我们回头看整个电影历史，任何一个国家的电影历史，一辈子导演会跟一辈的演员一起成长，就是到最后会大家一同的成长学习。那么，我这次很幸运的就是身边有一群很好的演员，然后呢，我觉得我们会长期的合作。话说回来，就是他们的片酬的问题其实都不贵，对，都不贵，但是。 话说回来，我觉得演员的片酬是一个市场定价的问题。就因为这是一个市场面的电影，《药神》是一个市场面的电影，我们会给到那个相对在市场上有号召力的演员，肯定是更多的片酬。然后呢，当时在市场上并没有那么强号召力的演员，可能相对低的片酬，这是一个市场定价的。
So in the lifespan of a director, I would definitely work with lots of actors, and I think the learning process for us both. So we will learn from each other. And for my actors, they were actually not that expensive. And I think the price of an actor is largely determined by the market. So the more attention and the more famous an actor is, the more expensive, obviously, he or she would be. And I think when I pay those actors, I would think more for the long-term relationship or long-term cooperation we can have in the future rather than just for this specific film.
在我的第一部长片里面，其实大部分合作演员都是剧团，然后一些戏剧团的演员，他们可能很少参与影视的创作，所以。 我觉得是一个相互学习的过程。而且当时可能我的理解，包括那样一个低成本的制作，我基本上会把演员当成一个道具去使用，说来有点无情，因为我要在更短的时间里面让他们去体现我要的东西。那但是那之后可能也会带来一些不太好的结果。所以到第二部的时候，当然很庆幸，因为我第一部的算是成功吧，所以就会有很多的演员经纪人愿意来跟你建立联系，希望可以有机会参演你的第二部电影。所以第二部电影的选角就没有那么复杂，但是当时我们对于几个演员的要求会比较苛刻，比如说年龄，还有他是否能够接受自己去做动作戏的表演，所以最后我们选择了那样的一个阵容。那也是因为我觉得就是演员提前对这个导演的以往作品有一个了解，他也知道你是在认真做电影，做电影的一种方式或者电影的一个创作的观念，他们也会全心的投入到这个电影里面。所以这样一来，其实反观他们的参与要远远比他们在这里面得到的所谓的那个报酬的东西要更重要，所以可能就不是很贵，然后也都很积极配合到影片的这种制作时间里头。
So for my first long film, we actually, a lot of my crew, my actors came from the cast that were in the past like performing plays. So they were not very professional film actors, but then I was using them a bit like my props. So that was not very, a very good technique as I now think back. And it's not a very good approach for keeping them, but then that is a lesson I learned. Then for my second film, thanks to the success of my first film, I was approached by many actors themselves, so it became a lot easier for me to choose from. However,Yeah, I had stricter requirements for each of the actors, like what they have to be able to do for those films. So that's the basis on which I selected my actors for the second film. However, like, yeah, the takeaway from this is how, because those actors have already seen your first film, they know that you are very serious about filmmaking. They know what you are, what the kind of things that you do. So they...have a very like strong personal interest in getting involved in the things you do more than the monetary reward that brings. So I think that is the way, that's like the way on which I was choosing the actors for my second film.
Okay, so this is the last question. I think I would, okay, the last question should be very short because we only have 15 minutes. Is it possible for you to yell?
Okay.
Like really loud.
今天我的问题非常简短，就是这里有您们的电影里有一些女性角色，你想通过这些女性角色表达什么？你对女性的认知是什么样的？第二呢 ，female roles in your movie, what do you think of? Do you want to surprise where your female roles and what do you think of the female in China in the world?
我觉得不能单纯用一部电影去反映导演对女性的观点，因为导演在描绘这部电影的时候，其实他想要反映的是那这个电影空间里面的女性的角色，而不是导演内心的女性角色，它是不一样的。
I think it wouldn't be the case that you can judge directors or define directors' attitude towards women as a whole by just one of his films, because in the film, the women play the role they play in the space or in the environment of that, in the special narrative environment of that film. So.I would just say that you cannot judge a person's attitude towards such a diverse group by just one story.
然后你问了一个我的电影经常会被问的，就是女性的角色。那我在书写这个剧本刚写完的时候，我跟我的监制讨论，我就觉得说我应该会被很多女性谩骂，因为我电影里面的女性是扁平的、物化的。同样的，我的电影里面也对宗教有些批判，但我的监制跟我说一句话， 他说如果你要顾虑这么多，那电影都不要拍了。
So when I was making my film, I was ready for all the criticism coming from feminists or whatever, for my flat portrayal of women or even objectifying or materializing women in my film, but also I also touches on lots of religious controversies in my film as well. So the thing that my producer told me was that if you are afraid to make people angry, then you just don't make any film.
在电影里面，我的女性角色其实是男人的附属品。那他们被大多数电影里面多数的男性物化、扁平化。那我觉得这不能怪电影里面的男性。而是必须要去反省为什么电影里面的男性会这样子去看待女性。因为我电影里面大概有两个，一个是比较上流的，政经条件比较好的，他们把女性视为一个附属品，在一个男人的场合里面，他们变成是一个附庸的角色。那在另外一个底层的男性，他们对女性的想象是非常贫乏的，他们透过大众媒介、电视、杂志，对女性是充满的物化的想象。就像如果我们走到伦敦的大街，看到精品店的女性其实是都物化的，他们受到女性的传递是这个样子。所以我的电影里面必须把女性建立成这个样子。
So for my film, I did not want to make a personal judgment on women, but rather a more truthful reflection of how women are in the society today. So in my film in particular, I want to say that it's not the fault of those specific characters or people, but we need to think more deeper into why these people think this way. And I think the answer lies in how the society is as it is today. So I've made two contrasts. So the first is the higher class society where women is just as a belonging of men and it's being as objects that is being shown off. Whereas in the lower class society, women are objected to public imagination and materialization objectification and by the popular media and even in all the advertisement we see today everywhere on the streets. So I think those act as a reflection of society rather than my personal judgment on the issue.
We have 5 minutes left, so other two directors, would you quickly comment?
我电影倒好像没有多少，一般问到我女性问题的时候都问我为什么程勇跟刘思慧没有在一起。对，一般是这个角度，就是说你这里怎么没爱情，我们感觉他们两个应该在一起。所以这个我觉得，当然你问的肯定不是这个问题。对，我觉得是这样，就是如果单从药神这个里边的这个女性角色的话，它一共有四个主要女性角色。第一个女性角色实际上是程勇的前妻，就男主角的前妻，他认为程勇是一个烂人，没错，他真的就是个烂人。所以说他离开了程勇，那是这样一个很，我认为很独立的，选择了自己下一步人生的一个女性。那第二个女性角色呢，就是刘思慧。刘思慧是上海所有曼丽白病这个群的群主，她统领着大概13个男性群主，然后呢，掌控了整个上海，甚至后来是全国的白血病的这个药物渠道。那这是第二个女性。第三个女性是吕受益的老婆。吕受益的老婆，当程勇来到他家里做客的时候，他敬了程勇一杯酒，满满的一杯，感谢了程勇。然后最后当他老公快要死的时候，他去求程勇可不可以救吕受益。这是第三个女性角色。第四个女性角色是一个老太太，她打动了曹斌，最后让曹斌真正最大的扭力是来自于她，让她放弃了追查程勇。所以这四个女性角色，我觉得从我的论述上大家可以看到她们在这个电影里甚至这个世界上的作用，而且他们真正达到了我们男人根本没法达到的。然后再说我自己对于女人，我从小我妈把我带大的，所以我觉得女性真的可以顶半边天。OK。
So when people normally ask me about my view on women, I don't get many of those questions. And when they usually ask me, they ask about why there wasn't this happy ending between the protagonists, why didn't they end up being together. But I guess this is not your question. There are four characters in my film. So one is Cheng Yong's ex-wife, and she basically was saying like how you are a useless person, and it is true. That's the kind of person Cheng Yong was. Then the second one, you have the group leader who had this contact of all the people who had all the leukemia group, and she had a lot of power because she had all of those connections, which Cheng Yong then used. Then you have the wife of the friend of Cheng Yong, and like she came to basically, she showed her respect to Cheng Yong for what he did for his friend, and she was also present when, when her husband passed away. And then you have finally you have the old lady who stood out from the patients and talked to the police when they were getting arrested, and finally managed to move the police to not arrest Cheng Yong. So you can see how each of those four characters have their special effects in the film, and they basically all achieved what man could not achieve. So I think this also partly reflects my perspective on women, because I was brought up by my mum, and I really truly believe in the power of women and what women can achieve.
其实的确我的电影在国内上映的时候，然后我每天跑路演，这个问题也是最常被问到的，几乎场场都有。但是这是第一次有一位男性观众问这样的问题，对，之前基本上都是女性观众会提问。所以其实我觉得作为一个导演，作为一个创作者，对于女性的那个观念，我就是完全认同黄信尧导演的那个看法。对，其实在电影里面你再去设置一个人物以及他的人物属性和需要起到的某种戏剧的目的的时候，可能不太会在一个框框里面去做这样的设计。对。
I do get this question a lot, but it's the first time that a male audience actually come up to ask this question, and I think it is like what the other two have previously mentioned in the film, especially when you're choosing a female character and her motivation story, and you'll be restricted by the narrative environment of that story.
然后因为在其实在新迷宫里面所有的角色其实它都有对于人性正反两面的一种描写，或者是中间那个灰色地带的描写，所以大家其实是平等的。那在暴力无声里面，我觉得没有必要是一种解释，因为其实在那个剧本在创作过程中，你在做大量的田野调查的时候，你会发现因为男性的劳动力他更多的都到别的地方去打工了，所以可能就会把一些妇孺留在乡村，而他们又没有能力去阻止这样的一种破坏或者污染，他们也必然成为这些污染和破坏以及盗采最终的一个受害者，所以这是一个现象，这是一个真实的状态，所以那肯定我会希望把这种真实去呈现出来。
So I think the main theme with my film is the struggle between humanity and morality, and this problem is applied to all my characters, so I don't discriminate my character based on this main theme. Whereas in the film, the males are bread earners who's working outside, whereas the female characters are being left behind and became the ultimate victims of all the consequences. I think it is more of a true reflection of what is actually happening, a real phenomena, rather than I personally intentionally make a story this way. So it is a reflection rather than a story. Yeah.
Well, end, Mom.
Okay, just throw a joke to end it. So have you enjoyed the punk of the heavy absurdity of reality? As a feminist, I want to throw a joke. In an Anthropocene and post-humanist era, have we ever thought of the thoughts of the lamb, the tomatoes, and the chicken leg? Thanks.
我手机呢？刚好放这儿。
我买个给谁？